For those who don't know me, I'm Bob Ellis, chair of South Downs Branch. It's with great pleasure that I'm welcoming so many people to this, which is the third of our web meetings that we've had so far since lockdown. Each one has been more and more popular, and we're looking forward actually to a huge number of people joining us this evening, not only from South Downs Branch, but from branches across the UK and across the world. So, just a message from me, enjoy. I'm now going to hand over to Keith and go quiet for the next hour, hour and a half.
Thank you very much there, Bob. I've just got some very quick slides I want to go through with our members here tonight, just to really run through some updates for IOSH. I don't want to take up too much time because we really are thankful for Jason being here tonight and for giving up his time to speak to us and sharing his story with us. So really just some short updates coming up on our events at the moment. July, we have got a plan coming up for that. We don't want to reveal it just yet, but it's something quite challenging we want to do with webinars. So please keep an eye on our committee mailer. Keep an eye on our South Downs microsite, and we're going to have something out to you in the next week or so. August is our summer break. A few of us need to go and catch some rays and take a break from being such a fantastic committee. So we try and actually stand down for a little there. 1st of September, we're going to be at Edwards, a machining company, to look at some of the challenges they've got. And then on the 3rd of November, we've got Sarah Harvey, who's going to be talking about behavioural in the workplace and how that relates to health and safety. Just some news and updates quickly, we go through. So IOSH, 75 years, it's fantastic. Please have a look in the latest magazine. There's some brilliant things for some brilliant people. I can see a few of the people are joining us in the webinar chat and are on this webinar that are in that magazine. So I just want to say, brilliant, great to have you with us. And here's to another 75 years. Obviously, I do have to mention that I've been name checked on page 42 and 43, but being a face for radio, they didn't include my picture. If you want to look at the magazine, please follow the QR code on the slide. Something that's come out as well is, as council members, which I'm one of, we get a leaders update. And one of the things that's come out in that leaders update that I want to share with our branch members is the details on the page here. So IOSH has done some fantastic work in returning safely, especially they've just released their educational supplement to help schools return safely at this time. There's some great webinars out there for construction sites as well. So please go on that link and have a look at what IOSH has done. There are still weekly webinars going on for COVID-19 to help our members to support people to get home safe. And ultimately as well, there's still the Careers Hub, which has launched early, and the IOSH Mentoring. So if you have an opportunity, please have a look at those on the IOSH website. They're there for you, our members. If you've got any questions, I'm sure if you put it in the Zoom webinar chat, then one of the other panelists or Ben, who's supporting this webinar, will be able to put the link in there for you. So just really, the next slide here is really, I want to move on to Jason. There's some information here about really, but I want to leave the rest of this to Jason to speak about his journey and talk about some of the mental health challenges that perhaps took him on that journey. So I'd rather, Jason, if you're ready, I just want to hand over straight over to you and I'll leave you introduce yourself. But thank you for joining us and hope to see you some questions and answers afterwards. Thanks a lot.
Welcome, everybody. Thank you for the opportunity for the South Downs Branch for inviting me to speak. It's been a bit of a weird journey for me from when I started out probably 10 years ago speaking to IOSH, telemeted in 2010. And since that, I've traveled the world. It's just a mad journey I've been on. But today, I'm going to go right back to the start, January 3rd, 1993. I was 24 years old. I was married. I had two children. At the time, I was working as a roofing labourer. I can't really remember much of a day apart from 7:30 in the morning, get a knock on the door, picked up, taken to work. It was a job I didn't want to do, so morale was down. But the job was pretty safe. But towards the end of the shift, things changed. The rush job came in, the unplanned work, and was asked to do the job, 2 hour job, and we had literally 1 hour to get, try and get the job done. 3:30 in the afternoon, I climb a ladder. 45 minutes later, I'm laid on the floor, trapped between two buildings, after falling from an unsupported ladder. I cannot feel my legs. So an ambulance was called. He rushed me to the local hospital. And by the time I arrived, my wife, she was already there. Initially, they couldn't find anything wrong with me. I had an x-ray and was told I was probably suffering from a condition known as spinal shock. And hopefully over the next couple of hours, a couple of days, it could either be a few weeks, but I would gradually get all my sensations back. They then decided to send me for a CT scan for a closer look, just to make sure. So I go off the scan, I come back in the room, wife, she was now sat inside. This time, the door opens and the doctor walks in the room and he's not smiling. And straight away before, he didn't even speak to me. I knew. This time he came, he sat on the side of the bed and said, "We have found a small fracture in your back and you have suffered massive spine injuries." And then he simply said, "You will never walk again." And with that, he just stood up and he walked out of the room. I then was sent for a major operation. Two titanium rods was put in the back, and then I was transferred to a spinal rehabilitation unit. This was 50 miles away from where I lived, and told I'd be there for up to 6 months. Now, I still honestly believe that I'd be sent there to learn how to walk, just like it is in the movies. But you're not. Now, I'd all been told I'd probably spend the rest of my life in a wheelchair. I was now also told that I'd be also doubly incontinent. Now, as a 24-year-old guy, this was sort of the final nail in the coffin. I really was struggling with mental health at the time, but trying to put a brave face, especially with my family and the parents who come to visit. They asked me if I was okay, and I put a brave face on, say, I'm okay. But deep down, they knew something wasn't right. But about through rehab, and I managed to get myself fit enough to get out of hospital. On April 25th, 1993, I was finally discharged. After being out of hospital for just one day, my wife, she walked out with the kids. Now, in her defense, she was 23 at the time. He was told, look, if your marriage or relationship has got some problems, the chances are it will not even last a year. We had problems for my accident. So in truth, it was no big surprise when she left. This put a massive strain on myself. I was trying to cope. I'd lost my legs, I lost my dignity, and now I lost my family. And I just really, really wasn't coping. All I'd done before my accident was football. I was football mad. Initially, all my friends, they sighed, they wouldn't go back to a football. And I said, no, you can't stop going to a football, you know, I'm gonna be okay. But this meant that I had to hang around with a different group of guys. And it was common, I assume, everybody, they all take drugs. But I decided that I would knock around because I would never get me to spin anything like that. But after just a few weeks of not speaking up, it changed. I was out somewhere, one of the guys who came to me, passed me an exit tablet. And I can remember, looked at it himself, do you know what? My life is at rock bottom. It could not possibly get any worse. And so I took it. And 20 minutes later, sat there thinking, do you know what? My life ain't too bad. I've still got my kids. But this was me drugged out of my mind. And it was the first time since my accident, I actually thought that I could cope. But I can never get that feeling again. And the next 2 years, then just spiraled out of control. Nobody can stop it. Even my daughter, Abby, she came back to with me full time. But unfortunately, it was too late. In January of 95, I was out somewhere. I'd taken a couple of these tablets. I kind of started to feel just a little bit different. And the next thing I can remember is I opened my eyes. I didn't have a clue where I was. Now, because of the drugs I'd taken, I was back in the hospital. I was in an intensive care unit on a life support machine. I had been in a coma for 17 days. My mother told us day 15, there is nothing more that we can do. We suspect we have serious brain damage. The advice, turn machine off. Now look for me, my dad said no. And on day 17, I finally opened my eyes. Now, the brain eyes I've suffered are not as bad as expected. I still have problems with my memory. I get easily distracted. My speech at the time, I could barely string two or three words together. And I still have problems with my speech today. The symptoms were pretty similar to much like having a stroke. So I then sent to a stroke unit for my rehab. I then spent 5 months in hospital. Again, I came out expecting this was going to be my bounce. You know, things had to go up for me. But in truth, I felt worse. You know, people around me judging me for what I'd done. I was still drinking quite heavily. Fortunately, I discovered disabled water scheme. And it sort of changed my life. So instead of being a part of the weekend with my friends, I'd travel and do some water skiing. It was a great adventure for me and my children. And it took me out of that environment I was in. But unfortunately, I was still having these dark moments. 1998, 5 years after my accident, I was finally offered some compensation. Unfortunately, for less than half the value of my claim. And it was very simply put to me, look, at the end of the day, you chose to go up a ladder and it was not tied on. And so if this gets to court, 25 or 50% negligible, you're probably running a 50-50 risk of actually going to court and getting nothing. I accept that. But then quickly told, we are very sorry, there are now further complications. And so the year 2000, my son Sam, who's now 8 years old, he came to be me and my daughter Abby. But I'll never forget though, that my dad went to pick him up. Sam, he came back down the drive, a little bag on his back with some of his clothes. But what do most 8-year-old lads also carry with them everywhere? A football. You tell me how I miss this for 8 years, but I'm sat in the garden on a patio, a lovely summer's day, watching my dad kick a football around the garden with my son. And I just suddenly became aware that I could never kick a football with my boy. And it broke my heart. But, you know, it does not end. You know, it was not me that led my daughter to ride a bike. I had to sit and watch my dad do that. After all these years, it does not end. Now, my daughter Abby got married in 2015. How was I supposed to walk my daughter down the aisle? On the 3rd of February, 2017, I gave birth to my first grandchild, a lovely granddaughter. But for me now, it has gone full circle, because am I ever going to bounce my grandkids on my shoulders at the seaside? No. And all because of something I did, something I chose to work one day that I knew was unsafe. But I have kids, I have a water scheme. 2005, finally, I got my day in court. And this I then do agree to pay money we had agreed on in 98. And my barrister said to me, if we continue and win, you'll get substantially more. But we are still in the 50-50 risk that we could leave here today with nothing. So I accept the offer. Told, I paid in 3 months. It took 2 years. I was fine paid some compensation. 14 years after my accident, received a cheque for £408,000. But I got it. Compensation. To compensate you for your accident. I think the first time I saw that cheque for £408,000, if I'm honest, first thing I wanted to do is to rip it up. Is this what I've been paid for the rest of my life? No matter what I've been through already. I realised I wasn't coping, but I got all this money in the bank. So what do you think I did? I started spending, but nothing I did meant anything to me. Spent the next 2 years back and forth to Tenerife. But Christmas 2008, I was back in the UK at a Christmas party, and some guy came out with, how come you're in a wheelchair? Have you had an accident? I muttered, yes. I was just really struggling, you know. It tried to convince me to tell this story. You know, I didn't want to do it. You know, I fell off a ladder on a building site, and that was all I was able to say to him. His name was Dan Terry. He actually did behavioral safety at the time. He said, no, I need you on my talks. When I do my presentations, I want you to do a live presentation. The first time I did it, I absolutely hated it. I thought, this is not for me. And the next time Dan spoke to me, I got back to Tenerife. But when I came back again, he persevered and said, look, come out of all these sessions. But by this time, my talk was about 15 minutes long. I couldn't wait for it to end, if I'm being honest. But we sat there for the rest of the day. And at the end of the day, one of the guys in there came up to me and said, that's it. That's made a difference. And from that moment, I got it, because this story is not about me. This story is about me telling my story. And hopefully people can take something from that, so it's up to them what's one day I put to work. Now, since my conversation, I drove rally cars, with mic lights and guys, and scuba diving, parachute jumps. 2015, I got awarded an MBE. I took my dad and Abby to the palace, but you know, not one day goes by, but that makes up what I've lost. You know, every day I wake up, and the very first thing I see when I open my eyes is this bloody wheelchair sat at the side of my bed. And I think to myself, why the hell did I just speak up that day? Do you know, I give it all back in a heartbeat to that chance again. Now, I do realise you do actually think it's I'm trying to juggle my presentations as we speak. I realise Max has affected my life, but you know, the hardest thing I've dealt every single day is what I've done to my family and my friends.
You know, everything's got to be done safely. You only get one chance.
I'd not been presented very long. I was approached by Outtakes to make a film. They did it. They kind of did something about being water skiing, so I've not been working. Then they asked me if they could go around to mum and dad to do an interview. And that was the first time my dad spoke. You know, and that is what I have done to my mum and my dad. And I saw to watch that, but the reason I started sharing was because I don't think people believe how bad my mum and dad are. You know, if I rang my dad now and told him I got a puncture in my wheelchair, he'd break down and sob. My mum has been affected, not so much by Max and me being in a wheelchair, more by what I've put them through over the years, that today she still takes antidepressants. And some people say to me, well, I think you're a brave man for doing what you do, but do you know, when I think about what I've done to my mum and my dad, do you know what? I don't feel very brave. My sister, she has been my rock. But my brother, he also struggled, not because I was in a wheelchair, simply because there was nothing he could do or say to stop me going down the road I went. And the worse I became, the worse that affected my brother. And then it goes to the rest of your families and your friends. Abbe is now 30 years old. She's a lovely daughter. She runs one of the companies I run. Sam is now 28. And up until he was 10 years old, you know what? I had not a problem. And then one day, though, he came from school with his football, kicked from training. He sat right in front of me and he asked me a question. Why have we never played football, Dad? I wanted to lie. I want to tell someone I'm involved in an accident that was not my fault. But if you can imagine the look on Sam's face when I said it was all because I had fell 10 feet from an unsecured ladder. And the look on Sam's face. Now, if I'm honest, we've had problems with Sam ever since. Now, up until about 2015, I had Sam out working for about a year. But now, Blue, he resigns. I can't do it, Dad. I can't sit and listen to that story every single day, which is such a shame because then my presentation, Sam, he would speak for a few minutes and not about me and him. He spoke about his granddad, my ex-father-in-law, because he was my boss. Now I know that my accident cost him his business. People lost their jobs. He then quickly lost his house. So I asked him quite recently, so how was my dad's accident affecting your life today? And you know what he said? He said that it's had nightmares of watching me fall. And as much as I hate the wheelchair, you know, I am more happy this happened to me and was my fault because could you imagine that it's your fault and it happens to your workmate or something I put to work? I struggled for a long, long time after my accident. I realised my accident was more about my mental health as much as the safety violation of course that day. I put myself and my family through a lot of hard times. But over the last 2 or 3 years, I have managed to turn my life around. Not because these problems are not there, because simply now I don't focus on the problem. You see, the problem is not the problem. The problem is your attitude about the problem. Now, I'm not big on quotes, by the way, but I've got this one. I absolutely love it. I don't know if anyone knows this, but one guy who actually said this, it was Captain Jack Sparrow. I always say to people, if you find yourself drinking a glass of rum at 10 o'clock in the morning, it does not necessarily make you an alcoholic. It just makes you a pirate. Just sort of makes me laugh a little bit. But the problem for me was this date, the 3rd of January, 1993. I was unable to let that date go. Every year that date will come around in the start, beginning of December. And I feel this dark, dark cloud coming over me, but not just affecting me. It's affecting the children. You know, Christmas was such a bleak time for me. The year that I had the children in my house, people start tiptoeing around me. I've ruined Christmas dinners with moods. And it would last probably till the end of January. And I still come out on the other side. But it was such a hard time. And when I got a conversation, I thought, do you know what? I'm giving my family some respite. So I used to go to Tenerife for Christmas. But even when I was over there, things were still pretty dark for me at this time. But do you know what? I can't change what happened to me. All I can change is my attitude about the problem. So now, this day does not grip me like it did before. I treat this day now much like another day. So when people say the 3rd of January, that date's going around, I've just chosen now it had no significance. It's just like another day. And the biggest part of this is it's down to me. It's down to my choice. So I become the boss of my future. You know, what's the point of having dark days when you have good days? This has taken a lot of practice. For me, I made some small changes in my life. People who sort of know me the last sort of few years, I see this massive change to me and say, you know, what have you done? You're so different these days. You seem so happy. You seem so relaxed. They're looking for this big change. But you know what I've done? I made a series of small changes in my life. And these small changes add to a massive thing. People actually noticing a difference in me. My diet, I'm eating a lot healthier. I'm drinking a lot less alcohol. My fitness is improving, some exercise. So my sort of physical side of it, I'm okay, but do you know what? I saw some dark moments. Still finding it difficult to put these things to bed. But I made some changes in my life. Was doing some reading. Books, I'm not an avid book reader. This is the fourth time I actually read this book. I'm starting again now. The Power of Now, it's about living in the moment. I found myself, I was always, I was in the past, what happened to me, and I was always full of anxiety, things that might happen in the future, being disabled, all the problems that might come around. So this book was a great help for me. The next book I read at Christmas, even though I was sort of in a lot better place, I still had a lot of anxiety. So that book really helped me. But the third book, this book has helped me the most. And it's a book by this really talented guy called Jason Anker, Paralysed for Success. Now, I could do some gamekeeping now, try and plant some seeds that you buy this book. The website address is at the bottom there if you buy it from. But really, this book for me was a final chapter of my life, of the turnaround. Most people, we bury our problems. And this is very, very relevant to what I've just come through with this COVID epidemic. People are coming back in different mindsets. So for me, writing things down did initially cause a few problems. I was revisiting things in my mind that I didn't want to go to. But do you know, when the book was done, it was like the final part, the final chapter had been wrote, and I could move on. The book for me gave me an opportunity to explain to some people how dark I was feeling at the time. But the book, like Mr. Talks now, always ends on a positive. You know, I've managed to turn my life around by making some simple changes. Most people will go through hard times. And what I recommend for every single person, please share how you're feeling. You know, we've been told so many times that sharing the problem, but be open about sharing the problem. Don't just share a problem with one person, say, don't tell somebody. Be open and tell your work colleagues that you're suffering. Now is the time more than ever, as we come out of this crisis, is to be honest with people. I battled for 25 years, hiding my emotions, hiding how I was really feeling. It's only since the last 3 years where I've been open about the dark parts of my life, to see a massive improvement in my life. So the wheelchair. Now, people say to me, do you wish you'd not had your accident? And for 25 years, my initial response was, of course I do. I give anything not to be in this wheelchair. But now I've had a change of opinion on things. Now I look at this chair now, not as things that it's taken from my life, but I look at this chair now and think, look at the things this chair has actually given me. Now, since launching this career 10 years ago, who would have imagined the place I've been to, the place I've been, the people I've seen, the friends I've now met from around the globe, I now call as friends. So this chair now is not something I regret doing. This chair is something I can now be proud of. It's given me a completely different way of life. And that was a different, all it came from was a change of mindset. So instead of thinking about things that I can't do, I now solely concentrate on things that I can do.
Stop and think before you do anything. You know, everything's got to be done safely. You only get one chance.
I'm a one-way motorway. I'm a road the driver away follows you back home. I'm a streetlight shining. I'm a white light blind and bright, burning off and on. Sky the stars upon tonight. I'm a little divided. Do I stay or run away? Leave it all behind. It's times like
accident. It makes me most proud, really, just his day-to-day, how he deals with everything, the strength that he finds to overcome everyday situations. He sort of sees the positive in everything, focusing on what he can do rather than what he can't, which I wish I could be a bit more like that. That's what makes me most proud.
He's turned his life around. He's come a long, long way. And I'm just so proud of him. It's unbelievable what he can achieve from how he was.
Since Jason's accident, what's made me most proud is what he's doing for a living now, and just trying to stop other people from going through what he's been through. To do what he's doing today and seeing him doing it day in, day out, I can't be more proud of him.
He's just come on leaps and bounds, really. Even going back to 10 years ago, he's just like really coming to his own. He seems to be accepting of what happened to him, and he's really just got on with it.
He would have never achieved what he has today if he hadn't had the accident.
He is still hardworking and driven, so I think he'd have still probably had a good life and achieved things. But
I mean, before the accident, he was just the same as us, living in council houses, 9 to 5 normal jobs, down the pub after work. And what he's done since the accident, from skydiving to
things like being invited to the palace when he got his MBE, I don't think things like that would have ever happened, and in travelling and meeting the people he has. So I think, yeah, he wouldn't be in the position he is today.
The things he's done, it's unbelievable what he's done with his life.
But I think now if Jason's happy, we're happy.
It's times like these, time again. It's times like these you learn to live again. It's times like these, give and give again. It's times like these you learn to love again.
You know, for me, my change how have been my mental health and mental well-being, just opening up to people, how I was feeling, not just changed my life, you know, it's had a massive impact on my family, and my friends, you know, my mum and dad now are more accepting about what happened to me than they have been, you know, in 27 years. So that is why, you know, what is my sort of legacy, that I've helped, you know, my family recover from what I put them through all those years. The slide been played then with my share for some strange reason. So let me just go back into it and just see if it'll work. This is something that's holding around for ages. Life is 10% what happens to you, 9% how you react to it. And that does sum me up since my accident, you know. I now just concentrate solely on things that I can do, not the 10% things that I can't do anymore. But I want to take you back a year before my accident. I've been a songwriter from leaving school. I was very, very arty, but do you know what? It was not the best paid job in the world. But do you know what? I absolutely loved it. And in 1992, I've been made redundant, being a fan man, find some more work. Now at the time, we used to have friends who used to work on power stations on the outages, and they got me a job. Now at the time, I was earning probably five times more money than I am as a songwriter, and yet I hated it. I was away from him 7 days a week. He put a big strain on my marriage. My wife was pregnant with Sam at the time. Every night, I was in my pub with lads drinking far too much beer, eating rubbish food. It had a massive effect on my fitness as well. Got finished with the season off that, ended up working on the building site. Again, I hated it. I was drinking really heavily at the time. The night before my accident, I was at a party with my supervisor. I can remember early evening him saying to me, come on now, we should get off, we got work in the morning. And because of my poor state of mind, I'm all right, I'm stopping out for a few more beers. Now, to tell the truth, I can't remember going. I can barely remember being picked up the next day, still drunk from the night before. So had my health and well-being influenced that safety that I made that day at work? Absolutely. And you know, that is my worry post-COVID. As we come out of this and people start going back into workplace, everybody will be affected by what's happened. Some people have been furloughed. I know, you know, money might have been tight. Other people have still been working. Some people have lost jobs. Some people, unfortunately, you lost family members and people they know. We're going to come back into the workplace and there's going to be so many people with other things on their mind. And we know having other things on your mind when you're at work is one of the biggest causes of accidents. People just switched off, not because they choose work unsafely, simply because they are concentrating on other things. Fatigue sets in, mental tiredness, people not concentrating. You know, the theory is that we're gonna have this massive bubble of accidents that come around the next 6 months to a year's time, simply because of pressure being put on people to get work done. We have to do something different. But I think instead of looking at this as a negative, we should look on this as a positive. Some people now can work from home part-time, which is having a massive improvement on their family life. So instead of just being worried about what COVID epidemic might do to the workplace, this could be an opportunity to look at technologies, look at things we can do to improve safety at work. So I'm actually quite excited for what the future will offer. Anker and Marsh, again, most of our work does disappear most consultants overnight. So what do we do? Take it online. We've got a load of work in America. It's fantastic. And that was just a brainstorming session about what we could do. We spoke last night at the meeting, you know, people are saying, what is this post-COVID going to look like? What can we do in the workplace? I think the number one thing we can all do is just stop being nice to people. I don't know how many people have noticed, but you know, I've not been asked many times. I've been to the shop, I've been to the chemist. And what I've noticed is that people are actually speaking to each other again, saying hello, good morning. Now, wouldn't that be a great place to go back into the workplace? So when we start a shift in the morning, just everybody speak to each other. Is everybody okay? Never mind the work stuff, never mind the risk assessments, just taking care of the people we work with. You know, this is not just about management down. This is us got the workforce looking up. You've noticed your manager or your supervisor doesn't see myself. Why have that conversation? Are you okay? Is everything all right? We have to come out of this in a better place, you know, than where we are. We have an opportunity to do something about it. My post-COVID rant for a lot of people is, I can remember washing my hands, we're going fashionable. Simple things like cleanliness can help without this pandemic. I understand how people can go to the toilet and not wash their hands, but that's the place we've been in. So please take care, everybody. We are going to do a Q&A session, so feel free to ask me any questions. And try to open the session up a little bit to be a more interactive conclusion to the session. So thank you for listening and thank you for your time. Thank you.
Thank you for that. We do have one question, Jason. So the first question we had come in was, what made you decide to start sharing your story?
Again, I had no wish to do this. It was a drunken conversation I had in a pub with Dan Terry. He'd heard my story. Ian Whittigan, I know I got to meet Ian here, but I know when Ian was alive, he was supposed to be speaking with Dan at a factory near where I live. Unfortunately, Ian's already started to take poorly, so he wasn't available on the day. But just by chance, Dan was in the canteen, and somebody who knew me, knew of me from the village, just mentioned, I know someone else in the wheelchair, Jason. He's got a bit of a story. And I met Dan, and I didn't want to do it. I still particularly don't enjoy the speaking part of it. You know, it's not what I was going to do, be a presenter, but, you know, it has literally changed my life. And again, I don't do it for myself. You can help other people. It's what I do it for. So, yeah, Dan Terry, unfortunately, passed away a couple of years ago. It was a great mentor for me, always there to help. Suddenly passed away, but yeah, Dan Terry was a guy who actually convinced me. Took him about 6 months of ongoing stuff to try and convince me to actually do this. So, yeah, all the thanks really goes to Dan.
We've got another question coming. I'm gonna ask this one, then probably leave and then rejoin because it appears you can hear me, but all my Zoom software has crashed on me. Okay. So, it is a bit of a long one, this. First of all, thank you for sharing your story. Have you forgiven yourself for putting your family through? Because I can still hear how raw and painful that is for you to talk about. From an outsider, you can see this story is surrounded by so much love and the lessons your children have gained through feeling that pain.
Thank you.
So really, yeah, so that's a question. Have you ever forgiven yourself for the pain you've caused there?
I finally think I have. I think writing the book was the bit that actually changed me. Up until then, it was a bit, you know, even watching my dad now, I always put my head down, I always try and zone out a little bit, because hearing my dad, you know, I don't think people can understand that. When I used to talk about my dad, how bad it was, to actually show the video, and people actually really got it. And when you see my dad cry, you know, we made an uplifting video quite recently. My dad cried again on it because it, the emotions in my dad. So now I feel I've appeased my mum and dad a little bit. I can see them being better about things. I think I've finally forgiven myself a little bit. But it's a thing, you know, it's a damage I've caused. You know, the kids grew up with this. And as much as I tried to give them, and my daughter says she's out there, my son said, you know, we had a great life with a dad being in the wheelchair, so I've nothing to be guilty for, but it's took me a long, long time. It took me about a quarter of a century, 25 years, for me to finally forgive myself. But, you know, it's in the past. I can't change it, but what I can change is going forward. So these changes I've made in my life is probably the bit that's actually changed my mum and dad. Now I finally, you know, come to terms with things. But yeah, it's a very, very, very long process. I hear it, do you know, I hear it a lot in now? When I've sort of coached or helped another speaker who's newly injured, I hear all that how they present and how they speak, all the things I was going through. So, you know, it is ongoing. Hence why I continue doing what I do.
Yeah,
you know, because it's 25 years. It's affected our families for 25 years. So, you know, it's such a long time for people's lives.
I've got a question come up. I'll ask the first question first. So this is from Andy. Hi, Jason. Thank you for sharing your story, which is really powerful. We carry out lots of proactive health and safety coaching, etc., but we still see too many accidents on site. If you could talk to your 1993 self, what could you or have done that might have stopped you from going up that ladder?
You know, the talks I give live now, that's why I brought all this mental health and mental well-being. It's become part of this presentation. You know, it's not safety, it's not well-being, it's not health, it's all one. And, you know, I used to beat myself up so many times. You know, I can't remember falling for the ladder. That's a bit of a blur. I couldn't be slipping. I can't remember falling at all. But what I can remember is being stuck on that ladder. You know, I knew it was unsafe. It wasn't tied. I knew the ground conditions were bad, were poor. You know, why didn't I just speak up that day? And for so long, that would have been the, you know, speak up about safety. And obviously, we have to speak about safety, report things you think are unsafe. But you know what? My accident had more to do with my mental well-being. People didn't speak about the person I'd been in the few months before my accident, you know, being late, coming to work, smell of alcohol. Nobody spoke up about this at all. They spoke about it the day after my accident. They then all came forward. Oh, Jason's struggling. We know he's struggling. So, you know, post-COVID again, I hate talking COVID all the time, but people are going back in the workplace in a different mindset. We don't know what people have been going through at home. You know, it's so imperative. We bring this as much as reporting unsafe acts at work. And, you know, if you see something unsafe, it's to just get a mindset of what the people are going back to. What is their mindset? Because if we can concentrate for, you know, Tim Marsh from the business part talks about it all the time. If we can concentrate for 55 minutes of the day on a really good day, if we are struggling at work, we can concentrate for half an hour, 25 minutes. And if we are doing a safe, critical job, how much are we actually just missing because we're not concentrating on the job? And I think the book demonstrates to me that the book gave me an opportunity to speak up. So, if we can speak about safety, speak about how we're doing, because people want to come to work. So if you're having a bad time at home and you come to a workplace, which is a nice place to work, you're feeling engaged, feel part of the team, you can have a pretty good day at work. And if you're having a pretty good day at work, the chances are you'll start working safely. But if you come to work, you know, we work all the time, you don't like your job, you get home late, you've been to the pub, you don't sleep properly, you fall out with a partner, the wife, you come to work, you've got a bit of road rage on the way to work, you're clocking at 8 o'clock. Now, what sort of person are you going to be at work that day? And I think that's a bit where we're missing. So hopefully, again, I always look for the positive. And maybe coming out of this crisis, we've all seemed to be like accepting that we're going to start speaking better. You know, if someone mentioned coming to a presentation on Zoom 3 months ago, we wouldn't have done it. Well, everybody's been doing it. And it seems a new way of being able to communicate. I've often said, we were talking last night, Keith, that if I do a live presentation, I would say one or two questions at the end of the live session. And yet on these sort of platforms, people are comfortable and they seem to ask more questions. So I know I'm rambling off the subject slightly, but to me, looking back on that day, 1993, what I asked myself, I should be at work that day, I shouldn't have gone. You know, I knew I didn't like the job. I was drinking the night before. I should say, I'm not even going to, I should not even be on site. Never mind speaking about the ladder being on site. I should not have been on site. So if any message of going back in time I'd give myself is I shouldn't have gone to work that morning because I was not in the right work, headspace to be at work.
Absolutely. I think really, you know, that sometimes people say that, you know, there's a difference between personality and attitude. And my personality is me and my attitude is how I deal with you. And people need to understand that their attitude and how they deal with people is their choice. How they respond to feedback is Absolutely. Their choice. What people say to you and how you react to that and how that influences your mood is your choice. And you need to sometimes just look back at yourself and really just accept that your mood is your gift. Only you can decide what mood you're going to get up in the morning. But, you know, having been on a mental health journey, not like yours, but I seem to spend most of my life introducing you on stage, actually, Jason. I think I'll do that. Most of my life, I just, here's Jason Anker. But we have got some fantastic comments that have come in. I just want to go through those. So we've got a comment here from Kieran Delaney, one of the council members for IOSH. And he says he agrees absolutely with your 1090 statement and how, you know, after his diagnosis with ill health, it was something how he absolutely, you know, it helped him, you know, come through that the other side. And I've got to say, you're one of the few grown men I know that can actually make me cry with that story. And I'm glad your presentation went on a bit longer because I had an opportunity to clean up, you know, the story about your son and your daughter just really does hit home there.
It has been a hard journey, you know, and I think for me, meeting Tim 3 years ago and he was a guy who really pushed me over to talk about the mental well-being side of it as well. And he's brought so much to the presentation. You know, we literally have, because it's health, safety and well-being. You know, people seem to want to choose safety or health or well-being as a separate thing. And it's not, it's everyone, you know. Yeah. If you can have a really good place of work, you know, safety and people are engaged and feel valued, you know, safety should start taking care of itself. You know, we look at rules and regulations, of course you've got to be there, procedures, they all got to be there, but, you know, create a nice place to come to work.
Yeah.
You know, again, I'm hearing stories already, construction, especially post-COVID, we feel under pressure, there's a rush to get deadlines met, and we just know where this is going to lead unless we do something about it. But I don't want to put a negative spin on this, that I think we have an opportunity to do something about it. You know, let's create a nice place to come to work because it costs nothing. You know, it costs nothing to say good morning in the morning. It costs nothing to go and have a chat with the lads on a Friday. How's your week been, lads? Anything I can do for you? I think visible management in this is going to be absolutely key because if guys cracking the whip is not going to get us through this.
Absolutely. And I hope you don't mind. I know actually we've got Andy here. Turner and Townsend have done some fantastic return to work guidance for clients and that. And if you're listening at the moment, please feel free to put the links to that guidance on going back to work safely in the Zoom webinar chat to all panelists, because it's just a really good, helpful check on how to get back and how to get everyone home safe. So if we just want to go back to the questions now. So we have got some more questions. I've got one here which I'm going to hold on to for the end. Got a question here from Steve Harris. Jason, many thanks for sharing your experience. What have you got planned for the future? And on a lighter side, have you tried snow skiing yet? So obviously he knows you've done water skiing, but he wants to know if you've hit the white powdery stuff.
No, I haven't. I will do. That is on the bucket list to do. I stopped water skiing simply because I didn't have the time to do it properly. And because I was training quite good, going back to skiing around the lake. But snow skiing, that's definitely on the agenda. Hopefully the new businesses are taking off. Again, we entered this lockdown, you know, all of a sudden our business just disappeared more or less overnight. And yet we didn't panic. We thought, you know, what do we need to do? So for me, I will be doing loads more Zoom. You know, we've got a business model sort of lined up is in mind to try help companies. But by me being at home more, it's going to help me personally have a better quality of life where I'm not traveling sitting in hotel rooms all the time. So I'm very excited. The Anchor and Marsh stuff is going incredibly well. Like I said, we've just starting some new work in America. But again, based, you know, using the platforms that are available. And I feel the social distancing is going to be around for a long time. So, you know, I hate the phrase of a new normal, but it is going to be with us for a long time. So how do we adapt? I'm hopefully going to do a lot of site visits, which I don't normally do. So people can see me on the Zoom chat. You know, get the message out to more people. Instead of like 50 people in the room, we can hopefully get out to a lot more people, so we can spend time visiting sites, following all the social distancing rules, and just have, you know, safest and chats with people, how they're coping. So yeah, I'm really, really excited that the opportunity that this crisis has actually given us.
Absolutely. So I just note in the webinar chat as well, Lucy has shared the link to Anker and Marsh. So obviously if they want more information about how you can support their business, there's the web link there in the chat for Anker and Marsh and for Proud to Be Safe. So both those links are being shared with all attendees.
Abby runs Proud to Be Safe now, so let's give her
give her a warning. But both those are being shared as a thank you to you. Yeah. And Andy has also shared the LinkedIn link to the returning after COVID-19 to construction sites. So that information to all panelists and all attendees is in the Zoom webinar chat. In addition to that, we have got some more questions. So I've got a question here from Tanya Cock. What would your message be to those that think they are invisible, that health and safety is a bore? And I do have to add on this. I did say to someone the other day when they said, oh, health and safety, it's a challenge. And I went, is getting everyone home safe really that much of an issue for you?
Absolutely.
But really value your view there, Jason.
Hi, Tanya. Anyway, I've seen Tanya for a while. Hi, Tanya. It's that volunteer. I mean, like you, Keith, you don't do this job for a choice because it's a vocation. I've not met many people in safety who do it because it's a job. We've all passionately sort of do this because we know saving a life. It's not just saving a life. You know, just making someone have a nice day at work is my new thing. Just make the workplace a nice place to come to work. And I think since I've been told with mental health, and we're now bang on about it, but that has been like the new sort of goal for me the last few years. But how do we keep going? Because I suppose even if you have 99 problems, that one success you have where you can turn somebody around or you save somebody from an accident, that one time is what you sort of do it for. So I salute anybody who does anything to do with safety. And I know it's a tough job for everybody at times. And sometimes the people doing the job are not people particularly like other people because they think, say, oh, here comes safety again. But, you know, it's down to everybody to value what we do as a job. And the safety professionals are out there sort of doing the site tours and all the stuff, the unglamorous stuff that some people might say. I salute everybody who does it. So, yeah, that's sort of a roundabout answer anyway.
Oh, that's brilliant. No, thank you. Thank you. So, got a question here from an anonymous attendee. It says, really interesting. Thank you for your story. And it was great for you to talk about the whole picture, including your mental health and our frame of mind, our behavioural aspects. Just really from that there, do you feel that looking back now, that your mental health had a lot to do with the decisions you made on that day?
I mean, the majority for me is everything. You know, I know my mindset. And it was like a light bulb moment. You know, I'd scratched around that ladder for so long. Why to speak or why? What was it? I always say there was sort of reasons why I did what I did. And the main reason of my accident, I blamed a lot of people for a lot of years. You know, I blamed the boss. Blame the supervisor for walking away from the ladder. And quite recently, I blame Nottingham Forest. And people laugh. What's Nottingham Forest got to do with your accident? Everything. You know, I was a big football fan at the time. Forest was playing the FA Cup on that Sunday. It was live on TV. All my friends were going to the match. The night before, the party, everybody was on about football. Bugs was meeting in, whether it was going. It was on my mind all day. I was in a foul mood because I knew I shouldn't be at work that day. I should be playing football with my friends. So that's why I say mental health is, you know, if just someone asked me on that day, are you okay? You know, what is it that's struggling? You know, I could have outpoured it. But obviously back then, we didn't talk about things like that. So for me, the quick win would have been, was someone asked me if I was okay. Because all the signs were there. You know, I've been late, turned up work, I had days off. turning up still drunk from the night before. People have noticed this, but no one has spoken about it. So for me, the mental well-being side, I get away from mental health. You know, mental health for me is people with, you know, medical mental health posture. Mental well-being is just day-to-day things that can affect you. You know, I'd been on this journey for about a year before my accident. Little knocks, losing my job, being made redundant, you know, being on benefits, all these little knocks in my confidence. So I got to this place, I was just going through days, don't want to speak up, don't want to make a fuss, so speak up. Generally, I was in that mindset, get the job done, get packed up, get home, maybe I'll catch the rest of the game, rest of the match up in the pub on the way back. So, yeah, so for me, mental well-being was the biggest driver. And again, how many people have been suffered with some kind of mental well-being issues after what we've just been through?
Yeah, brilliant. Thank you, Jason. Thank you. So we still have more questions coming in, if you're all right for time. Yeah. I am going to say as well, we've also been joined by James Quinn, who's the president-elect for IOSH. So when we finish with your questions, James is going to have a speech 5 minutes, and obviously he'll take a few questions as well. So, but we're with you at the moment. But just to let you be, make you aware of the plan as it changes by the second. Yeah. So I've got a question here from a gentleman called Steve Booker that you might even know. And he's asked, how do you feel the Ladder Association get more focus on ladder safety training when compared to other types of access equipment like towers and mupes that people readily accept training is required for?
Yeah, it's a tough one. Obviously, I've locked in the Ladder Association. I'm part of, you know, the No Falls Foundation charity as well. I find it baffling. You know, when I started working with the Ladder Association and realising the, you know, some of the high companies, you realise that the access equipment is available, and it's bothering that people still fall from ladders. I just find it, you know, how many more stories do they have to be? How much more training does people have to get to know how to learn a ladder properly? I don't think anyone who has fallen from a ladder can honestly say, I didn't know it was unsafe. They know, they've had the training. They choose to work on safely, and the mind boggles. There's no answer, because if we had the answer to this problem, we wouldn't be doing these presentations, because there's no need for us to do this job anymore. But why do people still fall from ladders? It's just beyond me.
No. So I've got another question here from Mike Dixon Friend. Hi, Jason. Do you tailor your talk differently when you can see the audience and how they're reacting? Does Zoom make it more difficult?
Yeah, absolutely. It makes it more difficult. I'm not going to profess that being live is always going to be the greatest thing. However, I've found that with these Zooms, you can still see faces. You know, it's still that live sort of vibe of the experience. I know we're thinking of doing some webinars where we will actually see people in the room, which is going to be even tougher. But as long as we see a few faces, and you know, it's telling, we've got to realise that this technology is only going to move forward anyway. You know, it's going to be, it's a great platform from what we're using already. However, I envision another sort of 3 months, 6 months, these platforms can get better and better and better. You know, and yeah, you might say it's always best live in a room, but yeah, so there's 50 people sat in front of me. You know, 50 people, maximum 2 sessions a day, 100 people. So this is an opportunity to open these sessions up to more and more people. And like I said, the live site visits we're going to do is part of this. So you do a live session, and you know, me personally might be the next big thing. Maybe seeing me live in a room doing a presentation, I don't really get too many questions. Hopefully, by seeing the presentation maybe on Zoom or whatever platform we use, then see me live on site and the site walk around, we may end up actually finding out more things from the guys, because they'll be probably more open to have a chat with you. Straight after the presentation, sometimes it's a little bit much. It's been really, really powerful. And Keith, you know, being in a room, you sort of feel the emotion. And yeah, maybe that is lacking slightly by doing these sort of Zoom presentations. However, I think it opens up to more, maybe you get some more Q&A questions afterwards, where people don't feel so overwhelmed by the presentation. So there's a few sort of pitfalls. It's never going to be the same as a live presentation. You know, I'm not going to ever say it is. However, it is what it is and where we are today. Maybe there's an opportunity to get this message out to more people. So it's a fine balance now. So hopefully we can get right and get sorted, that you still get a real live presentation feeling from a platform. And it is what it is anyway. So we've sort of got to accept where we are. So I hope that's what answers your question.
No, absolutely. So we've still got more questions coming in. We're good for time anyway. So just really very interesting listening to your story. Thank you for sharing. It's great to talk to you about the whole picture, including mental health and our frame of mind and the behavioural aspects. So that's really referring to them. But no, unfortunately, we don't know who that's from, but thank you for that. The other question I'll answer for you, if that's okay. So we've got, where can we find, purchase the videos, and can they be used in our work environment? Well, actually, under lockdown, they can use you in the work environment, can't they? After COVID, you will come... You're the first presenter to go to an oil rig, is that correct?
Yeah.
So and you travel globally speaking, so they don't just need the video, they can use you to speak to their members of staff.
Yeah, absolutely. The videos are a starting point, I always said that, but we're quite nice that Abby's been working tirelessly. It was Abby coming up with a sort of a solution. We're not quite ready to announce it yet what we're doing, but hopefully it'll be pretty near future, but it's going to be based around sort of webinars and Q&A sessions. And I think that we have to do it. You know, at the end of the day, if I can limit the time guys are traveling in vans to visit a presentation, 3 hours in the van, we travel, see me for an hour, back in the van, 3 hours, you know, that's time that could be spent at work. You know, is that really great for their well-being? The guys are being asked to travel on days off to come and see me. So I see, you know, these sort of talks as the way forward. I'm not just a stopgap. I really see this as a way forward. I mean, I don't want to say too much, but I mean, speaking to a couple of presenters, one from Australia and one from Canada, will be coming on board and sort of do some stuff for us. So potentially, we could do even better. You know, we've got a great stable, well, Abby has a proud to say, great stable of speakers. All taking some coaching at the moment. Some people not done it at the moment. We'll try and get people coached up to sort of use Zoom. I've been really nervous the last couple of days. It's the first full one I've done. I've done a couple of meetings and a couple of half presentations, and this was the first full presentation. And you know, I've done probably over 3,000 presentations, and yet this one sort of was a bit unnerving. A new medium, making sure my slides, you know, sharing screens. It's just a new way of working. So yeah, for me, it was a little bit nervous. So, but I do feel that there's some value in what these do. And like I said, there's some news coming from Pratt, so you sort of shortly anyway, to get it out of there. So watch Abby's website as much as you can, because she'll announce it on the LinkedIn anyway.
Just to really answer that question, if the attendees look in the Zoom webinar chat, links to both Anker and Marsh and Proud to Be Safe are there. Please follow those links, and that will take you to Jason's websites where you can purchase these materials or book him to attend in person.
Yeah, brilliant.
Okay, that's brilliant. So we've just got... just really looking through. So we've got a question here. How long did it take you to adjust to your physical condition after your accident?
Physically, I was fit. My kind of hospital, it was all about, you know, back then, 27 years ago, you wasn't allowed to leave hospital until you was fit. It wasn't a case of getting out of hospital as quickly. You have to leave physically, go every week towards the end of your rehab and apply to be let out of hospital. You had to tick all the boxes, and if you wasn't fit enough, you couldn't get out of the bath. So I was pretty fit, but mentally I was scarred for a long, long time. And even though I found a way of coping, you know, starting this job sort of 10, 11 years ago, the great boost for me, morale was better, but I was still sort of drinking quite heavily on weekends off. But since I've approached my mental wellbeing, accepted that I can't change it, you know, and I'm only look at things that I can do, not what I can't do. You know, the analogy of 90-10, it saves me all the time. I don't worry about things I can't do anymore. I can't do it. So I just concentrate on things that I can do. And now I get so much enjoyment out of life. And you know, this wheelchair has been a part of that change. So can I hate something that's actually changed my life? Probably changed my life for the better.
So, thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Jason. So just two more questions here. We'll take these two. And then I'd like to actually introduce Andy and also James Quinn, President-elect for IOSH. So the two questions I've got, speak up if you're not happy. Jason, what would have been your reaction had someone pulled you up on that day?
Do you know what? Probably quite angry. And I think that's what scares people. You know, because I was suffering, yeah, if someone had pulled me up, maybe I would have shouted. Maybe I would have done. But, you know, from the father-in-law in particular, the same father-in-law pulled me up and I shouted at him and gave him a hard time. What do you think he'd rather have chose? Me shout at him for the day and being grumpy, or living the thing that he could have stopped what happened to me for 27 years and he still goes through it today? So I think the answer is, well, work it out yourself. You know, what's the worst that could happen? Something going to shout at you or fall out of you. But again, stop an accident. You got to be prepared to speak when challenged every single time.
Okay, I think the problem is, Jason, everyone meets you now and you're sitting down. What they don't realise is you're quite a tall fella.
Yeah, I mean, I've just started standing. I've got a standing frame. I've not done it for a lot of years. And I still, obviously, in lockdown, my daughter's stopping with me. And I stuck in the kitchen in the frame.
You're about 6 foot tall, aren't you?
Just about 6 foot, yeah. Which is, it's bizarre when I stand up because you feel so small. When you stand up, you're sort of towering over all my friends. I sort of, you forget yourself.
Yeah.
The world seems very, very different when you stood up.
I've saved the best question till last. And the best question is, what's it like working with Tim Marsh? And I think it's fabulous, isn't it? It's brilliant.
Do you know what? Working with Tim, it's been my friend for so long anyway. You know, we go to boxing together and socialise outside of work. And we suggested working together. But Tim's Tim, and everyone knows what he's like. Oh, dear. It's been great because, you know, what can you say? You know, first time I met Tim was probably about 8, 9 years ago at an event, and just to see him and just know what a statue he's got, you know, what he doesn't know is just, you can write on a postage stamp, he knows everything. So it's just a great opportunity. But I hope what I bring to the Anker and Marsh team as well is this way in about what we need to do. And sometimes people aren't quite aware. And maybe the old COVID thing, what I've been through, has really helped us as a business, because we've been championing mental health and mental well-being as part of safety. You know, it's all one. We've been championing this for a while, and some companies have said, no, we don't want this. And yet now people are saying, we need this. So working with Tim is just every day, you know, it's just great.
Thank you for that, Jason. So I'm going to just, hopefully Ben is listening to me. Ben, could you allow Anne to just say a few words about the IOSH Benevolent Fund? Anne, I can see you're still muted at the moment. You're unmuted, Anne.
Can you hear me now?
You have the floor, Anne.
Hi, good evening, everybody. I hope you've had a wonderful day. I just want to quickly say a little bit about the Benevolent Fund. We are here. I'm a trustee for the Benevolent Fund, and it's something I'm really, really passionate about. We are here to help and support our members, not just through COVID-19, but through all the tough times that life, you know, brings us. So what I'd like to do is share the website with you. And there's two things. First of all, in order to provide the help and support, we need donations. We have 48,000 members. If each of us gave 25 pence, that would be £12,000. The more we have is the more we can help. Also on the website, there is an option where you can apply. Please, anybody who is struggling, please put in your application and it will be considered. Thank you very much, Keith. I'd just like to say thank you to Jason. That was fantastic. And Keith and the committee, you've done a fantastic job this evening.
Well, thank you, Anne. And you are very similar to Jason in one way, that you've both been strapped to a stranger and jumped out of a plane.
Yes, Jason, I did my skydive jump last October, which was to raise money for the Benevolent Fund and two other charities as well. So, but that just tells you where I am with helping other people.
No, thank you. Thank you. So I don't know if James, don't know if you want to just say a few words, and if you've got any comments on what Jason's been saying there, within IOSH? Well, you're still muted, thank you. James, please, over to you.
Yeah, thanks. Hi, Jason. Amazingly, that's the first time I've ever heard you speak. I've heard a lot of presentations in my time, and you know, that one is very moving in different ways, and it reaches out to a lot of people in different levels. I think it's like, I don't want to use the adage of Forrest Gump, but it is like a box of chocolates. You've got lots of little tidbits and bits in there that everybody can go into in the nicest possible way, from your dark days to your enlightened days now, and to that message. And not as a health and safety practitioner, but as someone who lives and breathes and sees both sides of it. So I from a personal perspective, I can't wait to see you in the flesh, so to speak, and I can't wait for you to come to my organisation and speak to us. Our biggest single challenge every day is working from ladders. And I sent someone home yesterday, Jason. I said, is that me red carded? And I said, no, I just want you to go home for the afternoon. Think about it, come back tomorrow. And tell me why you were hanging on to a bit of rebar, 12 feet up on a ladder, talking on a mobile phone as a supervisor black hat, when you've got four people looking around you. And it's happening today still, Jason. And it doesn't matter what you do or what we all do, all we can realistically do is just slowly but surely drip feed and keep punching away and just getting that message out there. And I absolutely applaud what you do. And thank you very much for being here today, mate. And Martha, Keith, Keith, thanks very much for the invite.
Absolutely. So obviously James is our president-elect within IOSH. So I would like to obviously, and we do have many council members here tonight as well, and as a council member. So next year is your year, James, as president, isn't it? And Jason, I think it would be great if through Louise, we could get you to do some webinars for IOSH to really get your message to our 48,000 members and to support James and his presidency.
Then you can not only be well-travelled in the physical sense, but also well-travelled in the virtual sense. Jason, you'll be the man in demand.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So we've got a lot of good councillors here tonight, a lot of great councillors here from IOSH, and again, that's spreading the message, because every one of those councillors are going to be asking the same questions at their branches and getting that message out there. And it's, again, you know, it's been a hard day today. I've been up since four, but there was no way I was going to miss this. I've phoned Canada, been phoning Germany, America. I've been up since four, but there's no way I wasn't going to miss this. So thanks again.
Thank you, James. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So with that, thank you, Jason. Thank you, Anne. Thank you, Jimmy, or James, as you are now. Just the final thing, I've put in the chat window the link for the South Downs feedback form. Please do fill it in, because without your feedback, we can't make these meetings the best they can be. Feedback is feedback. Someone always said to me, and some people take it badly, you can do three things with feedback. You can either ignore it. If you can't ignore it, you laugh it off. If you can't laugh it off, it's probably true. So if someone gives you some feedback tomorrow and it upsets you, it's probably true. And the only thing you can do is decide to deal with it and change yourself. So please give us feedback. We value it. You can either scan the QR code or you can click in the link I've just put in the webinar chat. But that feedback, if there's feedback for Jason, we'll share it with him. But let's make these the best meetings we can, because we're here as the branch and as the branch committee for you, our members. And with that, I'm going to say thank you very much.